relative to how long it's going to take you
to achieve that particular goal,
right?
Or to a state or a level or whatever it is.
So I'm going to refer to business, because we are talking about business, if I'm not mistaken. Mm. Am I in the right place?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to talk about business or reflect this from a business context, i.e. from an organization's perspective, as well as from a professional career's perspective. Because for me, they're all one in the same. Professional careers are pretty much roles within organizations, is it not? You agree? Disagree?
Yeah.
Thank you. So I'm sure you've seen these stats before, but it is terrible out there. Businesses are failing terribly. I'm sure when you drive on the N1 going towards Pretoria, just up on around Midrand, you can probably see one of the companies called T-Systems. It's a purple light, right? T-Systems, one of the biggest companies. They were retrenching not too long ago, right? They're retrenching for various reasons, and that's not the only company. It's a massive company that used to generate billions of billions per annum, but it's also failing. Because things are changing. You know, the world is moving at such a fast pace. Competition and just disengagement and a whole host of reasons, how quickly the environment is changing, technology and so forth, all of these things are coming together. And unfortunately, some businesses and therefore individuals are unable to withstand the change and to adapt accordingly. I'm sure you've heard the quote that says, you know, it's not the fastest or the strongest that survive, but the ones that are most able to change and adapt to that change, right? And unfortunately, we will continue to see more and more businesses fail. And depending on how old the institution is, we or you are not immune from these challenges as well. And so it's going to be very critical, it's really critical today, that we look at how do we avoid these challenges. And I'm going to share with you one of the most critical components, or one of the biggest weapons you can utilize in order to avoid this failure, right? I'm going to draw a few concepts to try and create context for you. One of them is The E-Myth. The E-Myth is a book that was written by Michael E. Gerber. He published it initially, I believe, in 1986. It's been republished a few times, and it's really about business and one of the greatest secrets that was revealed in business. And what he says is, one of the reasons why most businesses fail. Why do you think businesses fail? Let me ask you that. Besides the issues that I mentioned, yes.
I would say the inability to adapt to the external environment.
Yes.
Because external environment have got a big impact on your business.
Yes.
So if you cannot adapt to what the consumer requires,
yes,
then you have a challenge.
Yes. Any other comments? Why do businesses change?
The focus and refocus the attention on business is a big challenge.
It's a big challenge, right? It's not easy to change and to adapt. And one of the things that we don't realize when we are starting businesses is just because you are, this is the concept, this is the myth. You know what a myth is, right? It's when you believe in something that actually isn't true or that you don't have any proof of, right? So one of the things that we unfortunately believe, naturally and organically, that just because you are a great mechanic who's able to fix cars, you automatically think that it means you have what it takes to start and grow a business that provides that service. Just because you are a great beautician and are great with doing people's hair, therefore it means you can build and establish a successful salon or beauty parlor. Just because you are great at soccer, Ramaik, does not necessarily mean that you would be great. No, I'm not saying you're not.
So.
It does not necessarily mean that you'd be great at running a company or a business in sports or in soccer. Why is that? Number one, do you believe what I'm saying?
Yes.
Right? Yes. I do.
What I'm actually saying is not a fact. I'm saying one does not necessarily mean the other.
Yes.
Okay. But that's the assumption that we unfortunately make. Right? And what Michael E. Gerber says is that businesses are started mainly, and in most cases, by technicians, meaning the person who's technically able to provide that particular service i.e. soccer player, beautician, you know, even accountants. You know, sometimes we are surprised when accountants also fail in business. You try and call your accountant, hey, where are my books? He's gone. Business is dead. Right? He knows how businesses function, but he does not necessarily have the skills that it takes, right, to actually run a successful business themselves. So someone who's technically capable does not necessarily mean that they can successfully manage and therefore become a successful entrepreneur in that particular industry. Okay? So what I've done, and I hope this gentleman is not going to be too upset with me, is that I've tried to do the same in terms of a professional career's perspective. Just because you are great at those particular technical skills does not necessarily mean that you'll be a great supervisor or manager. Because being a supervisor and a manager requires a completely different set of skills. Leadership, time management, problem solving, etc., etc., right? It requires a different level of competence and skills. But what companies do a lot, again, organically, a majority of the time, is we promote people. We promote people there, and then we promote them to what's called a level of incompetence. Meaning we take someone who's smart and very capable, and then we take them and put them in a place where they don't know what the hell they're doing. Right? I'm sure you've heard of a concept called 10,000 hours.
Yeah.
Right? Malcolm Gladwell shared this concept that it takes approximately 10,000 hours of your time in a particular field. It's at that point that you become what's termed an expert in that particular area. So if you haven't spent 10,000 hours managing people, there's a great likelihood that you're not going to do a good job. There's a great likelihood that you're not going to succeed in the area from which you are being, or rather to which you are being promoted. And the same thing applies when you yourself are seeking to play a particular role or to pursue a particular career, is that to some degree, if you want to be successful from interview stages all the way up, it's important to have your hours. Whether it's through experience or whatever the case may be, but you have to develop those hours. It's not necessarily 10,000 hours that you need to, right, to qualify, etc. But it's important to understand that if you are going to set yourself on a particular role, a particular job, a particular project, or goals, then ask yourself, do you have the ability to do it or not? Now, unfortunately, as human beings, we're very egotistical, right? If you ask a man if he's good at driving, everyone's great at driving. Everyone is better than everyone else, right? Right? Everyone is a ladies man. Do you know what I mean? And the same thing applies. I forget the psychological term, but organically and naturally, we all believe that we are much better at doing something than we actually are. So we mislead ourselves. And that's partly where we start making the mistakes in terms of all of these big goals that we want to have, because we believe we are capable. And then we struggle along the way because we don't have the skills. We don't have what it takes. We don't have the right connections, etc., etc. Right? Now, in pursuing our goals, one of the biggest things that we do and why we fail is because we try and do everything ourselves. But guess what? We are unable to. So who's played sports in the room? Who's played sports? For those who've played sports, I'm not sure if yes, golf qualifies as a sport, but it's not necessarily a competing sport where you're actually playing or what's the word? How can I phrase this? But you don't necessarily have, it's not a contact sport, right? Right? It's not a contact sport where you are playing against someone as such, physically and otherwise. Everybody competes individually. But for soccer, rugby, netball, basketball, all of these team sports, and I think that's what they term, you'll know, Guti, you won't be great at all the positions, right?
Yes.
Correct.
Yes.
True.
You can't be great at all the different positions. Yes, there'll be the odd guy who's brilliantly talented, who can play many more positions and roles than the rest of us, right? But the big thing is, I'm sure you'll agree that an individual tends to be great at one, maybe two positions. The problem, folks, is that we try and do all the positions. That's one of the mistakes that we make, and that force us to be in a position where we make all of these plans, but we don't achieve them. It's because we're trying to do everything. And what happens when you try and do something that you're unable to do? It takes you longer, right? It takes you longer. Especially when you are lying to yourself, thinking, oh, I know what I'm doing. I'm sorry to disappoint you. In a lot of cases, you actually don't. All right, so Usain Bolt. Usain Bolt, when he was still running, in the last three Olympics that he was competing in, he ran 119 seconds, three competitions. He made $119 million US dollars. That means for every second he ran, he made a million. Do you think he loves what he does? Sorry, it's not a trick question. Do you think he loves what he does?
Yes.
He does, right?
He does.